Gerhardt's back.
The more things change, the more they stay the same.
From NJ1015.com, this is the new Jim Gerhardt podcast.
And again we go. See, can we get this big thing off the ground? I'm Jim Gerhardt along with Bob Williams. Bob, the story that I think is sort of gets under your skin more than any other is this business of political correctness carried to the point of utter absurdity at with Cherry Hill East High School.
Oh, with the prom. Goodness. Yeah, with the prom, with the party like it's 1776 theme.
Yeah, if you haven't seen that, I'm sure everybody has by now, I would assume. On the invitation to the prom, it says party like 1776.
Mm.
Well, first of all, what does that mean? I mean, what person thought of that? What does it refer to?
I think it has something to do with, well, Philadelphia, obviously, is the theme there. I think they used it in their tourism the last couple of years, party like it's 1776. Oh. And, you know, it's a happy time. We're partying because we're celebrating our independence.
Yeah, but the only party associated with 1776 was the Boston Tea Party.
Mm-hmm.
So does this mean the kids in Cherry Hill, they put on loincloths, they stick feathers in their hat bands, and they go throw tea into the Cooper River? What the bad word is going on here with this thing? But to compound it, the principal comes out and grovels.
Mm.
And he is apologizing to students who he may have let down. Now, I don't know how many students. We don't know right now who complained about it or why, or whether this is an institutional thing in which certain groups of people simply have to be upset about everything that turns up.
There are people out there that are watching for the slightest indiscretion.
You remember the comic strip Lil Abner?
Mm-hmm.
Al Capp, who drew it back, this would go back to the Vietnam War protests, 60s, 70s, and he had a group of kids in there, very much like some of the protest stuff that goes on now. And this was an organization he called SWINE, which stood for Students Indignant About Nearly Everything. And I think it goes partly with the genes. Yeah. I mean, they come out of puberty somehow, maddened nowadays.
Mm-hmm.
But part of it is just normal teenage angst. Remember back we were all rebelling against everything and scared to death. That's one part of it we don't talk about. Terrified. What in the hell am I going to do now? You know, I'm out. And there's so many choices nowadays. And your brain has been pretty much turned into silly putty by the internet.
Yeah.
But again, the party like it's 1776, it may have meant something. I've tried to find out. I can't find any source that says what that refers to.
Well, I found a website. It says $6 shirts, and
wait, let me back up a second. This is a website called $6shirts.com. They sell T-shirts.
Right, and they've got the slogan, party like it's 1776.
It must refer to something. Yeah. I don't know what. But for heaven's sake, people, let it go at that. But what you have here is a culture now, it's almost institutionalized opposition to anything that has to do with the European culture. Now, I'm assuming, and again, I just make an assumption, that their problem with it is that in 1776, I guess there was slavery. Is that because it seems to be the black students, the African-American students? I didn't see any great uproar among them, but at least somebody popped up and said, you know, they were offended.
That everybody could not party like it's 1776 because they didn't have the freedom to do it.
They do now.
Yeah, they do.
I mean, we're not asking anybody to get in a time capsule and go back.
Mm-hmm.
The thing is beyond me. But I remember Carl Rowan. Does that name ring a bell? He was a great journalist.
Mm-hmm.
And Carl Rowan was it was 70s, 80s, I guess, into the 90s. He was a columnist for major newspapers, and he was an African-American journalist of great reputation. Certainly his civil rights credentials were impeccable. And Carl Rowan once said something, I think, that puts a handle on this. He said, racial paranoia is driving us all crazy. Hmm. And this is exactly what is going on. Now, I can understand, if you want to be philosophical about it or historical about it, that perhaps the day has passed for European culture dominating the world, which pretty much it has. I think it's on its last legs right now doing that, and that historically that's not unfair because these things come and go. But I don't think we're ready for it tomorrow. And so this feeling somehow that you can just screwing yourself up into anger with body English, wipe out all European, which i.e. white. I don't know how to describe it. If you're white, it's scary. And if you're not, you know, you have to wonder, well, how are we going to start? How are we going to go about doing this? I don't know where this goes, where this ends up, what the end game is of all of this. But the times, they are a change, and there's no doubt about that. But this business to and changing history, as you know that. They are wiping out any trace of, want to wipe out any trace of the European culture. Now, I would like people to stop and think about something before you get totally carried away and in some kind of a cultural genocidal mood. I was looking up the statistics, the Civil War, which was instrumental, as you'll know, in freeing people from the slavery that was in existence in 1776. They had what was known, kids, as the Civil War. Now, the reason I'm explaining this is because if they are going to change the tickets to the prom and they're going to wipe out any mention of 1776 or American Revolution or the history, that era, then that means they have to stop teaching American history. I mean, no way you can continue to do it. You can't get around it. And so you also have to eliminate 4th of July, Independence Day. You are eliminating, what else do you have? You have, Thanksgiving. Right. And practically...
Memorial Day?
Memorial Day, yeah. Well, Memorial Day particularly because that's to war dead.
Right. Now, for all wars.
All wars. But this is what leads me into this now. The Civil War. And certainly one of the elements in the agenda for the Union, preserving the Union would be number one. Number two would be freeing the slaves and citizenship to everybody. You know how many Northern troops were killed during the Civil War in that effort? Most of them were white. There were other troops, obviously, but most overwhelmingly white. And the North, according to the more current updated estimates, 430,222 were killed in that effort. And I think there should be some note of gratitude for that. I jumped to World War II. You're talking about the Memorial Day. World War II. World War II, the casualties were overwhelmingly white. Now, this is nobody's fault. There were certainly African-American, Black, Asian troops fighting very courageously. But at that time, most of the people of the minorities were put in special service units, rather than in the front line, the fighting. And so the death toll was overwhelmingly white, or European, if you want to use that. And again, to carry this whole thing a little bit further, if they had not made that sacrifice and Hitler had won and dominated this country, and believe me, at times he got close. It was a race to who was going to have the bomb first to blackmail the other side and destroy. But if they had won, in this country now, there would not be any minorities.
No.
It would have been eliminated with this horror, with this philosophy they had of the Aryan domination. Think there's white privilege now? Well, God help us if you had that sort of white privilege. And that's what you would have had if they won. So a lot of people that you are demonizing these people, the groups, and the kids are being taught to do that. A lot of them are actually responsible for you being here and being able to do that and being able to make the principal make a jackass out of himself. I feel bad for the principal. I would think the principal and school officials are between a rock and a hard place. And that is, they were compulsorily educated. They have enough education experience to become school officials. So they must see this is a bunch of bullpucky. But on the other hand, if they don't do it,
they got to cut their losses.
They got to cut the loss, and the loss is you're going to have the lawsuits, the school board's attorney, the legal bills are going to run way up. If one or two soreheads decide they're going to have a suit, they'll have organizations who pay their part of it, but we have to pay the school district's part of it. And so they have to go along with this stuff. But I think what bothers me almost more than anything else in this whole matter is there's no pushback. that I can see. Maybe there will be. Maybe there has been some. A lot of this I don't know with the Cherry Hill thing. There have not been any group, any organizations, any individuals of stature who've stood up and said, this is bullpucky. Everybody, sit down and shut up for a while.
People are afraid to express themselves.
People are intimidated out of expressing themselves. That's a dangerous thing. That's a terrible thing. That's why I sort of see this culture as the train in the old Western movie. It's heading pell-mell, full steam ahead, and the bridge is out. and you're sitting back, and nobody's trying to stop the train. And the engineer and the fireman, the coalman, the people running, they're too busy up in the cab fighting each other over minutiae. Are playing the basketball pool, or playing video games to care. What a mess. You know what we need? It occurred to me. You know how this culture is in an hysterical state, really. If you stop and look at what's going on, just look at the news. Hysteria is going on. And what do they do in old movies when somebody was suffering from hysteria? You'd slap them. We need a slap in the face.
Slap of reality.
And we need it, and I don't see anything other than that to snap us out of it except a catastrophe. I don't want to see a catastrophe. Well, okay, on that happy note, I will talk about a note. I can't think of a segue.
That's fine. Good enough for me.
Perfect. All right, I tell you a segue, taxes. Taxes, that's a segue. So let's talk about that. If you're using, software and stuff in the past, it is that. It's the past. When it comes to taxes now with new tax laws and taxes that you might not know about, like estate taxes and taxes on top of taxes, sub-taxes, taxes, son of taxes, and on it goes, third and fourth generation taxes. So you need to take care of your assets. And my suggestion to you is that you put them in the hands of the CSI Group. And that's at 1-800-TAX-LAWS. CSI Group is made up of a dedicated and a very well-informed, educated service team, the structure. And they carefully select and assign specific members of the professional staff to your needs. And this is especially important, I think, if you are a person of some substance or you want to become a person of some substance, or you're in a business. CSI Group started off as a mom-and-pop operation, Peter and Sandra Greco, back in 1972. And they've grown into one of the certainly most important financial service operations in the area, New Jersey and New York. They will meet you. They have offices all over the state. They will be very happy to meet with you at any place of your convenience. And working together, they present a team approach with broad expertise in tax litigation, business advice, financial planning, retirement planning, estate planning. It could go on and on. So for anything that involves your assets, talk to the CSI Group. You know, we're all playing a big game here, and the game is that you work hard and you try to accumulate what share of the Earth's bounty or resources you can. And the rest of the world, their all job is to take it. Every time you turn around, there's somebody in there, especially with the internet now. Bob, you know how that works.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we are totally beset. We're like a June bug who fell into a duck yard.
Mm-hmm. And we're trapped.
So, look, help get out of the trap, and these people can help you. The CSI Group. Peter Greco and the sons and the associates, 1-800-TAX-LAWS, or you go to CSIGroupLLP.com or easier, CSICPA.com. Well, I was mentioning taxes, and it's almost as if the door opened. Comrade Murphy stuck his head in and say, you rang?
Yes.
But now, Bob, you were talking about gas prices.
Yeah, and they're talking about with the gas tax, which
went
up
increasing the gas
year,
tax at a time when gas prices are skyrocketing.
It's about $2.99, $3.05 a gallon average. I don't know what you paid recently. I just paid $2.99 this morning. I filled up.
They're just warming up.
And I figured it out. I was on E when I filled up for my Saturn. 15 gallon cost me $45.
Huh.
And that is up, considering the gas tax increase over the last year, that's up about $6 a tank full.
Okay, now.
And how about yourself? What did you?
Well, see, I put every car away except the Prius when this happened.
Smart man.
Yeah, the other car, except today I used the Miata. I couldn't resist.
Oh,
I wanted yesterday to do it.
Yeah.
You know, and put the top back. Yeah. It was a beautiful, gorgeous day. I run out and I jump in the Miata. Bzz, battery's dead.
Oh, God.
I hadn't used it for a while. So anyway, today. But what is happening here, I read this morning, and perhaps you know more about this than I do, you being around part of the morning show here. They're talking about an increase in the gas tax.
Yeah, again.
Again, and this will help raise money to pay for, I guess, the care and of the people, the illegal people who come into the state when this becomes a sanctuary state.
So we were at...
It's an expensive proposition.
So the original increase last year with Governor Christie was 23 cents a gallon.
On top of 14 cents.
Right. And now they want to add, I don't know how much more.
Uh-huh.
But I didn't hear anything about any of this money going toward road repair like they had
told
us.
Well, it never does. That's the hoax. It's supposed to go dedicated to the Transportation Trust Fund. Didn't they have a public question on that pretty much demanded it?
I believe so, yes.
Oh, so we put it in the public in the Transportation Trust Fund. Then they put a hole in the bottom of that bucket, and it drains out and goes into something else.
I'm not seeing any potholes being repaired either. I'm driving over the same holes over the last month, and they've had time to fill them. I mean, really.
It's New Jersey. Hmm. Well, I see now they got the state sign, the official state sign, construction ahead. Road work ahead, I guess is how they put it. But I don't see any road work. I see a lot of barricades and things going up.
Welcome to the road work state, yes.
Yeah, the road work state. Oh, just hopping around on a few things going on. I understand they did put the dog down.
Yes, Tank up in Sussex County, yeah.
You know what? Again, it bothers me. Gosh, a lot bothering me. felt like I sat on that Miata. I had cockle burrs on the seat, and I sat on it with my pants down today. They say, well, we exhausted all courses to no, you didn't. Nobody asked me. I'd take the dog in a second.
I'm sure you weren't the only one.
And I'm sure the man that got bitten, let's say that this was a fine person, very well intentioned, but he was not a knowledgeable person. I mean, the dog is protecting himself under circumstances like that. He's in a strange place with presumably a strange person. He doesn't know somebody's coming at his head with this harness or whatever. And the dog did what the dog's genes have trained him to do, which is to protect himself. Mm-hmm. And we, of course, have the same protection genes. But it's galling that they do that. And so anyway, that
even after the owners had complied, from what
they
I understood,
complied. But who's got money to $1 million? Yeah. I mean, average person.
I mean, I think they put up deterrents for the dog after the complaint or whatever.
Well, what they wanted is, I remember going back to Tarot that you and Eric Scott and I talked about last week, was they wanted a compound with 6 feet high or more inside another compound, which would be the same. Signs up all over the place. Yeah. It looked like Las Vegas with all these signs flashing dangerous dog.
And it just gets cost prohibitive. $1 million.
And it's impossible. And the dog did not do anything really wrong. He did something that turned out to be bad. But by the dog's lights, that was what you do. Now, they were talking about the animal control people who couldn't handle the dog or something. Mm-hmm. I had an occasion one time. There was a person who lived across the street from me down a couple of houses, had two large pit bulls. They were confined, so we didn't know how friendly they were. Obviously, they were friendly with the family and the kids. One of them got out one day, and he went up the driveway of the lady who lived next door to me. And she had just pulled in her car, and the dog was at the door, and she was scared to death. So she rolled the window down, yelled at me, "Please call animal control. I'm afraid to get out of the car." Well, I was not going to go over there and try to relieve her stress by doing something with the dog. I didn't know. So I called animal control. The animal control person is Burlington County. He came, and what he did was an exercise in patience. He didn't just go up with something, try to grab the dog, scare the dog, and create a bigger problem. He went up and sort of sat and cooled the dog down, talked to the dog, and put the dog at ease, got the dog out of the red zone. And so eventually I looked over and he was sitting on the porch steps with the dog beside him, like his best friend, like, you know, Cesar Millan and Daddy, you know, the from the Dog Whisperer. And then he put the dog in his truck, and he sat there, or I guess got on the phone, talked to the owners who came home and took care of the dog. But that's how they handled it. Now, if somebody had just gone running up in a panic and the dog senses that and starts throwing a loop around your neck, a noose, that's another story.
Absolutely.
Anyway, it was sad. What is not sad in New Jersey this morning? I'm trying to find something better. Okay, I tell you what, let me do this while we Bob searches for a happy thought. I want to hear happy, happy, joy, joy sound. What do you do if your real estate agent can't sell your home? You have to sell your home. You want to sell your home. You need the room. You need to move. You know, all the reasons. You try to sell it. The listing expires after 6 months. Well, you know I'm going to suggest you talk to our friend Rob Dukansky at RE/MAX First Advantage, the only person to talk to. Now, Rob guarantees to sell your home at a price and a deadline you agree to, or he'll buy it. There's no risk to you because he'll let you out of the contract anytime. Now, nice couple in South Plainfield named Kim and Brian needed a larger home for a growing family. So they wanted to sell, and of course they wanted the most money they could get to help afford a larger place with more room for the family to grow. However, the plans were stalled when that house was on the market with another agent for 6 months and nada, nothing. So enter Rob and his team. Rob's aggressive marketing generated a lot of interest. The home sold in just 34 days for over $310,000, enough for them to get the home that they needed and the home to grow in. So call the official real estate agent of 101.5, the only agent I would even think of calling if I needed to sell my home, Rob Dukansky, 855-350-1050. I did it again.
That's all right.
No, all right. You see.
Either way.
I 101.5 is important. That's who we are. That's the association. That's how much we're close to Rob. Rob Dukansky, the number is 855-350-1015. Regardless of whatever gnomes wrote this, the infinite number of gnomes and an infinite number of typewriters who came out with 1015. Look, call Rob at 855-350-1015 or go online to robsellsnj.com, robsellsnj.com, and start packing. And you can go to the liquor store, go to the mat with the person from the Chinese restaurant over the boxes, which I have done, and you go home and start packing. It's a great organization. You'll enjoy working with them. Bob, I'm going to take off my Mr. Know-It-All hat here and defer to you on this one. You are very familiar with the venue, the scene of that terrible school bus accident.
Up in Mount Olive last
week. In Mount Olive. This is on Route 80?
Route 80, toward Alamuchi.
You know it, your job not only as traffic reporter, but from living around the area.
I live about 10 miles from there.
You know this, Cole. All kind of stories and theories now, but let me ask you, what in your view was the school bus driver thinking about when he did a maneuver that allowed himself to be broadsided by a dump truck fully loaded at high speed?
That is a great question, because I think it's inconclusive right now. I mean, a lot of the details have not been released to the public, but you got to ask, you're scratching your head, like, what was this guy thinking?
Yeah.
The first report was that he did a U-turn. And then the second report was that he got off his proper exit, but then got messed up and wound up coming back toward the interstate. And then the theory is that he was getting back on Route 80 West. He sees the turnaround, the illegal turnaround, and just cuts across all the lanes of the traffic to get to that cut through. To right himself, and then he gets plowed by this dump truck.
Now, that's a little bit different from the original story about the U-turn, and I think Jeff Domensky
Jeff, of
the station who was on in the afternoon.
Yeah, that
Jeff
afternoon.
Is the one who did the investigative reporting.
Yeah, Domensky and Doyle, they were taking phone calls that afternoon of the accident, and I'm listening, and I'm hearing them talk about an illegal U-turn. I'm going, oh, my God, I know exactly where that cut-through is, that U-turn. That's where the state police hang out on the median there, and I was just shuddering when I heard that theory. And as the time went on, it certainly started sounding like that. Some people have seen the video. I have not seen. There is a DOT video out there that has not been released to the public, but apparently it's corroborating the theory that the driver was getting back on the interstate.
Well, they have cameras along those roads.
Yes.
Is that right? Who
but they
would,
have not, but they have
like
not released it. But,
well, it's a pretty terrible thing to see.
Yeah. So, I mean, it no matter what happened, it's just an amazing thing. Like, what was the driver thinking?
Now, this bus had seatbelts on it, right?
Seat
because
belt,
there was a
yes.
big argument in New Jersey for years and years about mm-hmm. that. Mm-hmm. And if it had not had seatbelts, then who knows what might have happened.
Yes.
Or
could have been worse, but yeah. I have never seen an accident where a bus has the cab has mm-hmm. been physically removed, ripped off the chassis of the bus. That was horrific looking.
Now, the driver almost immediately, I would imagine, would be taken somewhere and probably tested for
toxicology reports.
Yeah, toxicology report on it. But it takes forever. Remember that horrible train wreck in Philadelphia that they had? And immediately, the driver of the train, who I think later was found at fault, was immediately grabbed by the union lawyer before anybody talked to him,
right.
and it shut him up. And it was years before they mm-hmm. came out with the results.
This was an elderly bus driver. I don't know if you heard that.
No, I want you to tell me.
The bus driver is 77 years old, a Patterson resident.
Man or lady?
Man.
Man.
And we don't know much more about his physical health or what have you. But you would think that when you're getting to that age, why would he be assigned a long-term over-the-road trip like that? I mean, I can understand local duty, but there's a lot of pressure on you.
Did you ever go as a parent or a chaperone on one of those field trips?
Oh yes, absolutely. And
I did once.
Lot of stress there.
Yeah, and the kids were just. I mean, it was pandemonium.
Yeah.
But the driver of the bus was a little old lady, and she was talk about elderly. She looked like Norman Bates' mother, sitting up there.
So,
and she was just going on paying no attention to the kids, just going totally wild in the bus. Yeah. And we were going at flank speed on 295. I forget exactly where we were going. Mm-hmm. And she was sitting there with this little beatific smile on her face. And I thought either it's transcendental meditation or straight gin. I'm not sure which.
Gosh.
It is a good question. But... Well, of course, we're speculating. All these things will
it's
come
all
out.
Speculation here.
Yeah.
But it's just a tragic thing. And that the teacher that was killed, obviously, you talk about chaperones. The teacher, where the bus was impacted, that's probably right where the teacher was sitting.
It must have been.
Because the teacher sit up front
in
the front of the bus.
Girl. Oh, God.
Just horrible. And, you know, everybody was quick to blame the trucker, but apparently the trucker was just minding his own business,
going
with a full load.
They say there's no evidence he was speeding or doing anything.
No, he's in the center lane. That's what I'm hearing, and that he was just going along with a full load, and there was no way he was going to stop if a bus comes right in front of him.
Well,
like
I said after we were talking about Rob DeKansky, we're going to come back with a happy story.
Mm.
We lied.
Yeah. But it's been one of those weeks here in the state.
So many things going on. You had the Texas, the school.
Yeah, what do you say about that?
I don't know what you say. I don't know what
There's
you
been,
say.
It's like every 10 days.
You get the knee-jerk political stuff, but nothing practical coming out of it.
Yeah.
You had the governor of New York, Cuomo, mm-hmm. and he is writing this letter to the president, blaming the president for, why didn't you do something? Isn't it time you did something? Well, Cuomo's own party, the Democratic Party, they ruled the roost for 8 years before Trump. Why didn't they do anything about it? Mm. And the reason is, I don't blame anybody for it, is what do you do? And they seem to come up with this nutty idea to me that gun control, taking guns away from people, shutting down the National Rifle Association, all this is going to stop it. As I pointed out a couple of weeks ago, Bob, I don't know if you were working with me then, the largest school massacre ever to occur in this country was done with a bomb, bombs.
Right. Oh, yeah. Yes, we were talking about that back in 27.
Yeah, this guy was in Illinois, Wisconsin, somewhere in the upper Midwest.
Yeah.
He was a politician who had run for a local office and lost. And he was going to kill everybody. And he killed, I think it's still the largest school massacre in history. And he planted bombs in the basement under the school. He was a president of the school board, for heaven's sake.
Yeah.
And he was going to blow up the whole school. So there are so many other avenues. You see, we have a violent society. And I think it's time somebody started thinking about, if you want to have a knee-jerk response, jerk your knee in the direction of trying to cut down violence in our culture, because kids live in it, they grow up in it, and it just becomes a part of life. And I think in the mind of a kid, I don't know this, of course, never having thought that way as a kid, or nor did anybody in those days, I don't know that the kids know that they're doing anything that's real. You know, it's a big video game or something that's going on. And in with this culture that and children are besotted with violence, violent images, violent language, look at the so-called music and the like, many people, most kids, can live without that. Like the old days, they used to say, I can't let my kids watch Three Stooges, they'll be poking each other in the eye. Well, it didn't happen because the kids knew better. I'm not sure the kids know better anymore. So there's so many things that could be said, and I don't know what to say. How the only response is to shake your head. I don't know. Well, we'll work on that later. Okay. And next week, a happy thought. We're really going to dig.
Enjoy your Memorial Day weekend.
Oh, is that coming up?
It's this week.
That's time?
Yeah, that's happy.
Oh, for heaven's sake.
That's something to be happy about. Summer's here.
But can we have it this year? Can they have it in Cherry Hill?
Party like it's Memorial Day weekend.
They may not be able to do that. So party.
Except if you're in Cherry Hill. Enjoy your weekend.
Oh, God. Providence, who watches over children, drunkards, and fools with silent miracles and other esoterica, please, God, continue to suspend the ordinary rules and bless the United States of America.
Thanks for listening to the new Jim Gerhart Podcast.
Still cooking, and it's bigger than ever.
From NJ1015.com.